The folks at Blender Foundation have just announced and released Blender 4.3, the beta. And this comes with some interesting quality of life tool that will allow you to start creating in Blender. Unlike previous versions of Blender, this might be considered as a massaging update and version of Blender for artists to start working with. So for those who like to get this, all you need to do is go over to blender.org, go all the way to download, go down here where you find download Blender experimental, and from here you'll be able to download Blender 4.3.0, the beta. And you'd also notice that 4.4 is now in alpha, and the same thing can be said for both Windows, Mac, and Linux. And currently, Blender 4.4 has literally nothing, as this was just announced, but we'll be able to see some updates coming to this, and this will be coming out of alpha in February of 2025. However, Blender 4.3 is currently in beta, and the beta will be running from now till November the 6th of 2024. And with this said, let's dive directly into Blender 4.3, the beta, and start exploring it. So, with Blender 4.3 simply opened up right here, you'll notice that we have a beautiful looking splash screen. So, for those who like to start off by importing their 4.2 preference, you can simply go ahead and do that. But if you'd like to start off with a new preference, you can do that as well. In this case, we're going to import the Blender 4.2 preference and we're going to load this in. So first things first, once you take a look at Blender 4.3, you literally notice that there is little to no update. I mean, first glance, this is what you get to notice. But once you start fiddling with this, you start noticing some stuff. Right now, the auto key now has a color. So once you turn this on, it now shows the red color, which is not what you get if you take a look at what we have with previous versions of Blender. Another thing that you notice is, in this case, if you're trying to animate any object at this point, when inserting keys, all other keys get deselected, leaving only the newly created keys selected. All of the icons now use independent SVG for higher resolutions, especially doing UI scaling. If you pay a lot of attention to the status bar, you would notice that there's an update to the status bar. Things are now aligned all to the left compared to Blender 4.2 when you have these icons justified across the status bar. Now let's talk about areas, as this is pretty cool. Now if you like creating various areas when working in Blender, then 4.3 would actually make you smile a lot, as there's a huge update to this one. The hit size, for example, for resizing areas have been increased, and there is a little bit of some sort of transparent animation for you to actually see what you are doing. So at this point, you can just simply move things around and you can split it. And, you know, if you like to also split some more, there is just this beautiful way of doing this right now, which looks super, super cool. So I can actually go ahead and move this one around and I can tell where it's been placed. You know, it's more interactive in general. Compared to what you have with previous versions of Blender, this is not the same. This now makes it even more easier to explain to new Blender users how to cut and also work with various areas inside of Blender. And speaking about areas, there's a tiny update that is also here. So by default, if you like to merge these two together, what do? You simply go over, find where the midground is, and we can right click and join area. So by clicking on the join area, you can either go up and down just to join the area. And you know, if we like to do the same thing here, we could say we'd like to join the area left and right, and then you can join the area. Super cool. However, they've made it a bit more simplified in this version. So if we right click, we now either join up or join down. And I think it saves you that thing of going up and down. And you can also do the same thing. If you like to join here, you can join right or join left. Depending on what you want, you can now simply get that going. And this is really cool. Blender 4.3 also comes with some interesting updates for tooltips, as tooltips for colors is well adjusted and it looks more cleaner. There's a new textile which has been added for tooltips, and if you simply hover across a data block, it now shows you the preview of the image, video, or fonts that exist within that data block ID selector. And something that's super interesting, especially for file management, is if you simply go over to your file section and you go all the way down to your open recent, once you click on clear recent file list, there is a dialog box that allows you to either select if you like to remove all of them or if you like to remove only items that are not found. So in this case, we'll go over to the file. I believe there's a couple of items that we moved around just so we shouldn't be able to see them. So I guess maybe something like this. Let's go ahead and stop that animation. Go over to file, go all the way here. Cairo Street Night, I believe. Yep, so something like this is no longer available. So once we go over to file, we go over to open recent, clear recent file, we can now select this and click on remove. So it's only going to remove the files that are no longer found within the directory where they were opened previously. So if we go ahead and check it again, we shouldn't be able to see the Cairo Street. And when it comes to the properties, there's a couple of tiny little updates that exist with both the look and feel of the entire properties section. But there's one thing that kind of stood out when we were about to light this character. And it has to do with this, that once you have a light selected and you go all the way to the light section, you would now be able to create animation action. And this animation action has to do with the light. Meanwhile, if you go in and you turn on the use nodes, automatically you now get the shader node tree action as well. So in this case, you can now connect these things together and get working with it. One other thing that you may have noticed that is missing is textures. So we no longer have like that texture section here anymore. However, if you like to connect with that, then you might want to go over to your shader nodes where you can start manipulating with all of that. And here's another cool thing that you might actually see. If you go over to the Blender icon and you go to About Blender, there's an update to this. So, you know, just fiddling around and found out that there's an update here. This is now more cleaner, larger than what you've got here. And it's, you know, it's got a bit more boxy feel to it compared to the entire rectangular feel. The only thing I'm not sure about is alignment, because it seems to be slightly misaligned compared to this one, which seems to be pretty much aligned right here. Blender 4.3 the beta substantiates the brush asset system, with the brush asset system finally coming to this one, as it is one of the major releases that is now here. So if you simply go over to the asset browser, you would be able to find all the brushes here. So by default, we did make a video about this one where we talked about the brushes that was coming alongside the hair tools that were already in Blender. Now these brushes would cater to every single thing that has to do with brush inside of Blender. Mostly the sculpting, grease pencil, mesh texturing, mesh painting, and vertex painting. And let's not forget the hair brushes. So if you simply go over to the asset browser, go over to the brush section within the curve scope, this is where you find all the brushes that has to do with the hair. If you like to start making the hair, sculpting the hair, you can literally start off and start doing all of that. So if you like to play with the brushes to any of these places that you swing into, you would find the brushes right within the asset section. And so with the hair brush, just like with every other one, once you have the brush selected, you can simply select from any of these brushes that exist right here. So let's say, for example, we'll like to use this very first brush. We can use that to start combing, and we can style this however we choose. You can also choose to grow or shrink the hair depending on what you're trying to create. So you've got all these brushes here that you can use to start making amazing things. And the same thing can also be said for the sculpting as well. So right here within the sculpt, you would notice that what we have is a single brush. All of the sculpt brushes that you need now exist around here. So what that simply means is at this point, you will be able to select from here, just like you could do with most other 3D tools, and start sculpting. So for example, if we would like to simply use the inflate, we can have that selected. Then we can go over to where we would like to inflate, and we can start inflating just that part of the model. We can also go ahead and do the same thing. The cool thing is this is now in the main view. The last time we talked about it, this wasn't. So it's pretty interesting to see that this is finally available. So if you like to also add some blobs to this, of course you can. So we can also go ahead and style this monkey however we want. One other thing you will notice is right around here that we've got general and we've also got paint. So these two are the basic ones that you get. However, if you click on this button, you can switch to simulation and you get to see simulation here. So all the brushes in regards to simulation, they now appear there. If you also click on this button and you go over to general, you can also choose to turn on some of these other ones as well. So we can actually go ahead and turn on all of these, and then we can also have access to them by simply going through. So if you like to do some simulation, you want to have access to some sculpting tools, you can actually go through and play with all of that. So it is quite interesting to see what we have right now. You can also click on this drop down. If, for example, you have some brushes that you've actually linked up to your asset browser, you can select from your asset library and populate the brushes as well. There's just a lot of interesting things that you can do with this. The fact that you can just simply select the brushes and start sculpting instead of the endless scroll to find the brushes is pretty, pretty cool. Now, one other thing that you guys may want to know is if you can still customize your brushes. And yes, you can. So for example, if you like to make a customization of the brush, we're simply going to use the blob brush in this case. All we need to do is go over to the tool setting of the brush and click on the drop down and also click on duplicate asset. Now, once we do that, we're going to give this a name, for example, blob X1, and we're going to have that selected. Now, any of the changes you make within the settings for the blob brush X1, that is the setting that it's going to have. So we've just made a few setting changes in terms of the hardness and the spacing, And all we need to do is add a bit of multi-res so we can have a bit more of a subdivided mesh to sculpt on. And once we're done, the next thing we need to do is to try out the brush. And you can see that there's a huge difference with our new blob brush versus the original one. So you can definitely make copies of brushes, customize them however you want, and start sculpting whatever you want. You can simply go to town with this one and it looks super cool. So for those who've been thinking, is this possible? What can we do with it? Yes, there's a lot of things you can do. And this is across the board for every single thing that has to do with brushes. So in this case, if we simply switch and go over to the Vertex Paint, you would also notice that the Vertex Paint has its own brush collection right here. If you go over to the settings, you can also choose to duplicate this asset and change it to whatever you want. And this is pretty cool. The same thing is said for the weight painting as well, and also the texture painting. So for the texture painting as well, you can also choose to do all of that. And how you actually do your texture painting is pretty simple, since all you have to do is go over to the texture slot, click on the plus sign to add a new base color, because that is basically what we like to paint, and we can start painting. So you can literally take on any color, start painting your model, and doing some cool stuff. I would want to say something though. Contrary to what we saw in the early preview of this, this performs a bit better. However, it would be nice to get a more boosting performance, but for what it's worth, it looks pretty cool. And of course, you can choose to use any of the brushes that exist here and do all of your texturing. At the same time, I'm going to put some links in the description just in case you'd like to see some free and some paid add-ons that you can start texturing with as well. And speaking of things that you can still do with Blender 4.3, let's go all the way back and talk about Grease Pencil. So Grease Pencil now has the Grease Pencil Draw, the Paint, the Sculpt, the Weight Paint. They all exist here. And we know there are different ways you get to start using Grease Pencil. So whether you would like to work with it in 2D or you just want to use it to sort of compensate for 3D composition, Grease Pencil just makes sense. It's pretty cool. And a lot of people love working with it. And Blender 4.3 comes with something that is even way better. There is now support for Geometry Nodes. So at this point, you can mix your modifiers alongside Geometry Nodes to start creating interesting looking stuff. The modifiers are super cool, and mixing this with Geometry Node just brings everything full circle. So in this case, if you start off with Grease Pencil, we can simply go ahead and, you know, write the word B for Blender. And once we've got that, we can start throwing in a few things. Let's go ahead and take a look at the modifiers. And for this modifier, I would want to add, let's say, an outliner. Let's go ahead and do that. So we're just going to put in an outliner and we can increase the thickness of that. And this is what we've got. So you can actually see this in 3D. Now we can send this all the way to Geometry Nodes if we choose. So I'm simply going to click on this button, type in the word Geo Nodes, and we can throw in a Geometry Node modifier. Another thing that we can do is to simply go ahead and jump right in. So I'm just going to go and drag out a new panel, and we can switch this to Geometry Nodes. So let's go ahead and take a look at this, click on new, and we have it right here. So there are a few things that you can start doing with this. First off, you can choose to start resampling this object. If we simply go over to the edit mode and we have this selected, you can see what we have here. Now for all of these things that we have here, you can tell that we have some points. And we can choose to resample that right now. So for throwing a resampling node, we can choose to resample, increase this by count, reduce this by count, you know, do all of that. So even if you load in a monkey head or you load in an SVG that comes in as a Grease Pencil file, you can also do the very same thing. So with this here, what we're going to do is to simply convert it to mesh. And to do this is simple, throw in the curve to mesh and you can simply connect them. And we're going to use a circular curve as the profile curve to convert it to mesh. Now you probably wouldn't be able to see this because we're still looking at this from the shaded view in Grease Pencil. And what we need to do is to see this from the shaded view on the viewport, and we're going to click on that. And right now you can start seeing it. So there's a lot of possibilities of things that you can now do with this. And this includes you going in and throwing in modifiers and allowing these modifiers to do all the magic once you press the playback button. So imagine creating a Grease Pencil, throwing in the modifiers, using the Geometry Nodes to drive this. It is pretty wild what you can get. And speaking about Geometry Nodes, there are a couple of things in regards to Geometry Nodes that is here for Grease Pencil as well. So right where you see the spreadsheet, you can now have access to the Grease Pencil, and underneath it, you can have access to the layers, fill, spline, and also control point. And for Geometry Nodes itself, there are some interesting updates that deals with merging layers, which you can work with, And with the new geometry node, it is now possible to add gizmos to node groups, as this allows the editing of the input node directly within the 3D viewport. And I think this is one of the first steps to getting us into interactive physics with geometry nodes. So for those who like to see some more nodes that are currently available, you can simply go over to release nodes and check all of that. Animation currently has a very tiny update, and one of it has to do with the bone eyedropper, as the bone properties now show an eyedropper button to pick the bones. For modeling and UV, the update here is very, very minimal, and the same thing can also be said for Cycles as well. However, Cycles does have a few updates to the Principle BSDF, the Orin Nair BSDF, and also AMD and Intel GPU support from Metal backend is now fully removed, and the volume scattering node now supports more phase function, in addition to Hennian Grissin Rayleigh for atmospheric scattering, Fournier for RAND for underwater scattering, Drain for interstellar scattering, and Mi for clouds and fog. For the video sequence editor, there's a few updates that are now available that has to do with the timeline, preview, UI, sound, and also performance. For extension, there is nothing happening within the extension. However, there's a lot of things coming to extension. If you simply go over to the extension website, which I'm going to link in the description, and there's actually a pretty cool add-on from the folks at Blender Studio that might be coming very soon. Rendering has one interesting update that has to do with the Metallic BSDF, and this new Metallic BSDF node has now been added to allow artists take advantage of this in recreating some very interesting materials. However, Eevee does not support the conductor for now, so internally, it remaps the index of refraction and extinction coefficient to colors and then uses them with the F8 tint approximation. And speaking about Eevee, there's a few updates coming to Eevee. Light linking and shadow linking is now in Eevee. So if there's any Blender scene that you have, which you did your light linking for Cycles and you're wondering when this is going to come over to Eevee, it is now here. So you can now take full advantage of this and start doing all of that. We've covered a video about how you can do the light linking. So just in case you'd like to see that as well, we'll probably link it in the description for you. There's also some interesting updates to the Vulkan backend, which is now in experimental. So for those who like to test this out, all you need to do is go over to the system section within the preference, and you can switch the backend and start exploring that. The compositor does have a few updates that are now here. One of them includes the fact that multipass compositing is now supported for Eevee. The GPU compositor now supports CryptoMath metadata necessary for exchanging CryptoMath through EXL by simply using the file output node. There's also the new global save as render option that's been added to the file output node to be used if the use node format is enabled. And with Blender 4.3, the auto render option has been removed. For pipeline assets input and output, USD has a few updates, and Core also has a few updates. In terms of Python API and the text editor, there's a few updates that is available in different sections of Blender. So just in case you'd like to see this, see some of the breaking changes, all of these I'm going to link in the description. And speaking of things I'm linking in the description, for those who like to get the best of Blender 2024, then this is currently running out. We kind of thought that it was going to run out sometime last week, but it did give an extra 6 days, and this is running out this week. Like after this week, it's probably not going to be here. So just in case you like to grab them, then you can. Other things that you can get off Humble Bundle right now is the Ultimate Sculpting and Character Mastery Bundle. This is from the folks at Clip Normals, and there's a couple of interesting things that you can get, from alphas to VDMs, all the way to understanding how to sculpt realistic models, concept models, and so much more. So all of these are currently available, and I'm linking every single thing in the description. So this is it. Blender 4.3, the beta, is now available. And like we mentioned in the beginning of this video, this is more like a massaging update to previous features that are now available in Blender. This tool is currently available for you to download, play with, and report bugs so that you can help make Blender better. So this is it. Tell me what you guys think about this one in the comment section. And of course, if you like this video or you learned something from this, you can go ahead and give a like, and don't forget to share with a friend. And if you're new here, it's going to be amazing for you to hit the subscribe button and also turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next video or the next update. And until I see you guys in the next one, peace.